A reading from the book of Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to Shebnah, who is over the household, I will thrust you from your office, and you will be cast down from your station. In that day I will call you my servant, Elohim, the son of Hilkiah, and I will clothe him with your robe, and will bind him with your belt on him, and commit him the authority to his hand. He shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. And I will place on his shoulder the key of the house of David. He shall open, and no one shall shut. And I will fasten him like a peg in a show palace, and he will become a throne of honor to his father's house. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
O Lord, your merciful love is eternal. Discard not the work of your hands.
O Lord, your merciful love is eternal. Discard not the work of your hands.
I thank you, Lord, with all my heart. You have heard the words of my mouth. In the presence of the angels, I praise you. I bow down toward your holy temple.
O Lord, your merciful love is eternal. Discard not the work of your hands.
I give thanks to your name. For your merciful love and your faithfulness, you have exalted your name and your promise over all. On the day I called, you answered me. You increased the strength of my soul. The Lord is high, yet he looks on the lowly, and the haughty he knows from afar. O Lord, your merciful love is eternal. Discard not the work of your hands.
O Lord, your merciful love is eternal. Discard not the work of your hands.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. O the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him, that he might be repaid? For from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
At that time, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do men say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon bar Jonah. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against you. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. O depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? We heard those words in the second reading of today's Mass, from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. They are words that capture the mystery of God and his infinite nature. He created human beings in his own likeness, and so we share in God's intelligence, his wisdom, and his creativity. The advancement of knowledge over the centuries is staggering and has served the good of humanity. But at the same time, it can lead to a sense of arrogance and pride, and a belief that we as human beings can achieve anything we set our minds to. Even for many believers, we have lost that sense of awe and wonder God's greatness and majesty, and many grow more and more fascinated by what human minds and hands can achieve, whether it be the latest computer technology, medical advances, or exploration of space. This is not a new temptation. It is one that has existed from time immemorial, and is characterized in the Bible in the account of the Tower of Babel. People of the time thought that they could build a tower to reach heaven. God confounded their efforts and caused them to babble, speaking different languages so they could not understand one another. We must never lose our sense of God as mystery. Mystery is not something that we don't know or which is hidden from human beings. Indeed, we do know mystery, and it is open to our knowledge. Because we are finite human beings, our ability to grasp the full impact and meaning of mystery is beyond our human capacity. The key thing for us to remember is that we grow in our understanding of mystery. And that is what the life of discipleship entails. We can never claim to know God fully or to understand him fully. No matter how old we are, how wise we are, we all continue to grow in our appreciation of mystery and how deep the mystery of God is. This growth in our understanding of mystery happens when we are able to understand more of what the meaning of life is all about. You know, science, as important and as necessary as it is, tries to break things down into their different components to understand how they work. But faith, on the other hand, tries to combine the diversity of human experience, human knowledge, and the science of the times into developing an insight into meaning. What is the meaning of all this? What is the purpose? And here, we are helped greatly by the person of St. Peter, who we heard about in the Gospel. St. Peter helps us so greatly to understand the endeavor to come to grips with the meaning and the mystery of God. In the Gospel of today's Mass, we heard Jesus pose the question, "Who do men say the Son of Man is?" The disciples gave him various answers, John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. Then Jesus puts the question to them, "Who do you say that I am?" Jesus renames him Cephas, rock, and says that on this rock he would build his church. Peter is a fascinating character in the Bible, because Jesus clearly chose someone who was weak in order to lead his church. Soon after his proclamation of faith, Peter had to be warned by Jesus, "Get behind me, Satan." He was an impetuous and impulsive man, who, when he saw the Lord after the resurrection, jumped off the boat fully clothed. He was slow to understand the mission and message of Jesus. He was fearful and even cowardly, denying Jesus three times. Even after the resurrection, when he was challenged by eating with the pagans, he backed down. He deserted Christ when he was crucified, and was not standing with Mary, John, and the woman at the foot of the cross. Yet, the same man became the point of unity for the new world church. Other apostles deferred to him. He would eventually give his life for Christ, witnessing to the suffering and death of Jesus. So what did Jesus see in him that caused him to choose him to be present at the most important events of his life, such as the Transfiguration? What caused Jesus to appoint him as the rock on which he would rule the church? The virtue of Peter is to be found firstly in his humility. He accepted the view from Jesus without getting miffed or going away sulky. When he recognized his sin in denying Jesus, after proclaiming that he would never do such a thing, he wept and repented with great humility, and so sought forgiveness for what he had done. Compare that with Judas, who betrayed Jesus and then gave him to despair and committed suicide. Peter was a leader of his ego, who endured the threat of disagreement, challenge, and even his own bad decisions without giving up. And his second great virtue lies in his faith and trust in Jesus. Just think back, after Jesus' teaching on the Eucharist, where he told the crowd that unless they ate his body and drank his blood, they would not have eternal life. Most left him, unable to accept this teaching. Jesus asked his disciples whether they too would be. Peter simply said, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have a message of eternal life." Despite all his impetuousness and his mistakes, he believed in Jesus and saw in him the source of life and salvation. And his third and greatest virtue lay in his love for the Lord. Three times he was asked by Jesus whether he loved him. Three times he replied, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." It is through these virtues that Peter was able to grow in his understanding of the mystery of salvation and the mystery of God himself. From a superficial understanding of Jesus, perhaps as a political liberator and a wonder worker who wielded earthly power, he entered into the depths of God's wisdom and his ways, to the extent that he was able to offer all to God, eventually gave his life for him. And so Peter is really a source of hope for us. We see so many of our own weaknesses in him, and yet God chose him and worked wonders through him. In our own openness to God, we know that we can deepen our appreciation of the mystery and the unfathomable nature of God. We move from superficiality of just seeing Jesus as our friend, to which is our wrong, but growing into a depth as we continue to search and to seek understand and to seek to understand better. Like Peter, we need humility, we need faith and trust in Jesus, and above all, we need to love him. Dear friends, daring thy feet to confess Jesus as the Christ, let us pray to the living God with trusting hearts.
For Pope Francis, Bishop of Rome, and all bishops and pastors, that they will bear constant and joyful witness to the Son of God. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For Christian communities in every land, that they will minister the healing mercy of God to all who seek it. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the leaders of nations, that they will promote world peace by renouncing the testing and storing of nuclear weapons. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the world community, that remembrance of the abolition of slave trade will herald an end to human trafficking. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all those who work or volunteering benefits for the community, that their service will inspire us to care more lovingly for one another. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For those facing greater loss because of the COVID pandemic, especially women and the young, that the just economic measures will ease their burden. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all those whose mental health is at breaking point, that they will reach out for the help that is offered to them. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For families and friends unable to come together for celebrations of joy or of sorrow, that bonds of love will keep them united. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the recently deceased and all the faithful departed, that with all the angels and saints they will rejoice in God's presence forever. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. Living and life-giving God, you anointed your Son Jesus as Savior of the world. Keep us true to his name. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. For you so loved the world, that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer, to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours, that by sin we have lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, of all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy,
may he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and the glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we live for our unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Stephen, our Bishop, Sylvester, his auxiliary, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom we have summoned before you in your compassion, O merciful Father. Gather to yourself all children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom, that we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, to whom we bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, say this commandment formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. From the kingdom of God, Lord Jesus Christ, who said to the apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I leave you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always, and with your spirit. Let us not return to the sign.
Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
people they